Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Antelope Valley College Performing Arts Theater for this morning's presentation, Flight Test Engineering and Saving Lives, by Jessica Sting Peterson. A few items prior to the start of the presentation. Please note the fire exits are located on the left and right of the theater, as well as the rear of the theater. Photography or videography is allowed during today's presentation, but no flash photography. Please be respectful of individuals around you. Please do not stand up and block the view of patrons around you. No food or drink is allowed in the theater except bottled water. Again, thank you for joining us this morning. Now, welcome to the stage, Antelope Valley College President, Dr. Jennifer Zellett.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome. Thank you so much for being people who are spontaneous and able to make plans and come and join us on a very short timeline. We want to welcome SOAR high school students who come to high school on the campus of Antelope Valley College. Go ahead, give yourself a hand. Thank you for joining us today. We want to welcome our Antelope Valley College community, our students, faculty, and staff, any of our board, and any of the community members who may be here. Thank you for making time in your day to celebrate STEM learning and events coming up in our area. I especially want to thank a team of people who worked over the weekend to make this possible, and I'm going to name a few people who sat in on some meetings, but I want all of you, as you're going out, if you see people dressed in blue shirts and black and they're house workers, thank them, because this was an unexpected event and they have worked very hard to make this possible. So I want to thank James Nazipak, Cliff Layton, Liz Diachin and the marketing team, our Veterans Affairs office, Michelle Hernandez, Dean Greg Borman, and our VP of Academic Affairs, Dr. Howard, and I just had a mind blank. Davis, there it went. So, it's really a pleasure today to bring to you a presentation from Ms. Jessica Peterson. Jessica is an instructor flight test engineer at the U.S. Air Force Test Pilot School, and she's technical director for the operations group at Edwards Air Force Base. She's conducted flight tests on fighter, bomber, and unmanned aircraft. She's flown in over 40 different aircraft and has gone supersonic, which you all know is faster than the speed of sound. And she's been up to 50,000 feet, nearly 9.5 miles above the Earth. The highlight of her career was when she got to shake the hand of a pilot whose life was saved by a system that she helped develop. And she's gonna talk to us about the system. It's called the Automatic Ground Collision Avoidance System, AutoGCAS. There's so much for her to share with us. There's so much to learn, and it's all very exciting. And the impetus for this presentation today is that next Wednesday, there's going to be what is called a STEM flyover, bringing awareness to STEM education. And she's gonna talk to you today about the planes that you're going to see and some of the things that you can learn. So I would like to invite Jessica out at this point, and I would like to give her, welcome Jessica. College, I want to give you one of our t-shirts that speaks our theme of this year, to serve students and be kind. And I want to give you an Antelope Valley College coin. Wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here and meet you guys. So you've already heard a little bit about my background. The thing that I really want to foot stomp, so I'm a local, so I'm just so happy to be here and to meet you guys. To have the career that I've had, I'm actually a civilian, so civil service for the Air Force. There's a couple things that I had to do. So I had to get an engineering degree. Both my bachelor's and my master's degrees are in mechanical engineering. You can see the schools that I went to. And then after that, I took a job at Edwards Air Force Base. I first did an internship, and then I took a full-time job. I've been out there since 2005. I've gotten to do some awesome stuff. One other very unique, something I'm very appreciative of, is I got to go through test pilot school as a civilian, qualifying me as a flight test engineer. And so I get to fly in the backseat of aircraft. I've flown in over 40 aircraft at this point, and I'm gonna show you a video of some of those things. So with that, let's get into the presentation. All right, so Edwards Air Force Base. So we are the home of American flight tests. We've done many different things over the years. I have a couple things up there. The one thing I'm going to highlight today is supersonic flight. We have the 75th anniversary. It's going to be next Friday of that event, and that happened at Edwards Air Force Base. So where is Edwards? Well, it's close to you guys. So here's a map. You can kind of see, all right, it's in California. Zoom in, all right, it's north from where we are right now. Zoom in again. It's this big gray block on Google Earth. And then finally zoom in. So this is a picture, satellite imagery of Edwards Air Force Base. The reason it exists is that lake bed. So you see that tan lake bed? That is a very smooth surface that we actually can land airplanes on. So we have 22 different runways out at Edwards, and most of them are on our lake beds. So if we have an emergency, we can use those different runways to land. So that's why we have it. The other reason that Edwards is out here is because we get over 300 days a year of beautiful sunny weather, which is perfect for flight tests. And so that's why we exist in this area, in the Aerospace Valley is what we call it. There's a lot of history to Edwards Air Force Base. The two that I want to highlight, because there's two schools out here named after these test pilots, are Joe Walker. So Joe Walker was an X-15 pilot, which was an experimental aircraft that we were using prior to the space shuttle and prior to going into space flight. Joe Walker received his astronaut wings. He went high enough to qualify as space two times. He was the first person to ever do that. And Joe Walker High School is, or Joe Walker Middle School is named after him. The other is Pete Knight. So Pete Knight also flew the X-15, and he still holds the fastest manned aircraft flight. He went Mach 6.72, meaning he went 6.72 times faster than the speed of sound, which is pretty amazing. And Knight High School is named after him. All right, so as I mentioned, we have the 75th anniversary coming up of supersonic flight. And so the Bell X-1, which was an experimental aircraft, broke the sound barrier, Mach 1.06, at 43,000 feet, which is about 8 miles above the ground, so very high altitude. And it was an engineering team, that's what I really want to highlight, a team that made this happen. So Bell Aircraft, Lawrence D. Bell, was the owner of the aircraft company that designed the Bell X-1. There was NACA, was the name of NASA at the time. The NASA scientist engineer, John Stack, he was one of the critical folks in design of the airplane and having data to make sure that we were doing this safe. And then probably most of you guys all know the name of Chuck Yeager. He was the Air Force pilot that was in the Bell X-1 to do that. So amazing historical event, and we'll be celebrating it next Friday. So with that, I'm going to talk about supersonic flight. So these photos are beautiful photos. I love them. They were taken by NASA a couple years ago. It's called Schlieren photography, and it's where you can see the pressure differential of air coming off an airplane. So these are T-38s that are going supersonic, and you can see the shock wave coming off of the aircraft. And so you can see how that air changes as the airplane is moving through it. When you hear a sonic boom, that is what you are hearing, is this shock wave that's propagating from the airplane down onto the ground. So this is a good way to visualize what supersonic flight does. At test pilot school, we like to teach how that can affect the flying next to an airplane. So I'm going to show you a video in just a moment that is going to have a supersonic boom that's going to happen. And so what you're going to see is the T-38 is out in front. You have an F-16 that is behind it, and you're going to have these shock waves that are coming off of the aircraft. As those shock waves propagate, you're going to have it moving the airplane around. And so you're going to see how that affects the aircraft. So let me show you the video. This video you're going to see is of me. You can tell from my little blonde hair that's out the bottom of my helmet. I'm in the T-38, and on the right-hand side, I'm going to have an F-16 that's coming up. As the F-16 passes, it moves the airplane. So if you heard it, the pilot said, "Did you feel that?" "Yeah, I felt that," is what the backseater says. "Oh, that was cool." So the thing I want to talk about too is that test pilots and flight test engineers, even though we get to do this all the time, we still think stuff is pretty cool. All right, so as I mentioned, supersonic flight. So we have special airspaces at Edwards Air Force Base that allow us to do these types of testing. So the Bell X-1 supersonic corridor goes right over Edwards Air Force Base. It's at 30,000 feet and above, and that's where we can do flight tests of supersonic aircraft. All right, So now, let's talk a little bit about some of the programs that I've been able to work on and the systems with those. The first I'm going to talk about is automatic collision avoidance testing. And so these are two different systems. One is the automatic ground collision avoidance system. So this is a system to prevent airplanes from hitting the ground. And I'll kind of go into the technology of that. The other is the automatic air collision avoidance system. It's not to prevent hitting the air, it's to prevent hitting another airplane. So preventing mid-airs of two aircraft. So first let's talk about why. Why do we need this? We did a study. So from 1992 until 2004, we had 86 pilots that died in the US military. So this is Air Force, Navy, Marines, that were due to controlled flight in the terrain, CFIT, which means there's nothing wrong with the airplane. It has to do with either the pilot passing out, not realizing how close they are to the ground, maybe being in the weather and not seeing the mountains, or sometimes we'll have spatial disorientation where they don't realize which way is up. We also had mid-air collisions where two airplanes hit each other. So that's a lot of pilots' lives that were lost. We also had 156 aircraft. So that means that sometimes the pilots were able to successfully eject, but we lost a lot of airplanes, which cost a lot of money, and that related to $3.7 billion. So it's a problem. It was a problem that we had. And so we were charged with figuring out, how do we fix this problem? How do we save these lives? How do we save these airplanes? So we came up with these systems, and it was a joint project between the Air Force, the Secretary of Defense, NASA, Lockheed Martin, many different people. I was just one small part of that team to make that happen. We projected that once we fielded this system over a 20-year period, we'd save 172 pilots, 209 aircraft, and $10.7 billion. I'm going to show you one of the saves, one of the pilots' lives that has already been saved by this system. On the F-16 alone, we've already saved 12 pilots. So very rewarding to work on this program. So that's the why. Now let's talk about the how. The first part is the driving philosophy. So this is an automatic system, a computer that takes control away from the pilot. So a computer flying your airplane. You can imagine for pilots that have been used to flying their airplanes, there's a little bit of trepidation, a little bit of concern about doing that. And so the number one priority is the computer should do no harm, meaning it can't do a maneuver that breaks the wings of the airplane or makes it more aggressive and hurts the pilot in the airplane. So that's the first thing. The second part is do not interfere, meaning the pilots need to be able to do their normal flying. They have to be able to fly low level. They have to be able to take off and land. They have to be able to fly formation. And so we have to make sure we don't get in the way. And then finally, prevent the collisions. So that's the third priority. Even though it seems like what we would focus on, we have to make sure the design allows for those first two things. Before I get into the nitty-gritty details, I want to give you a little background on flying an airplane. So to be able to be in the F-16, there's multiple types of training that I had to do. The first one is called the altitude chamber. So when you fly in an aircraft, when you're at very high altitudes, there's a lot less pressure in that air. And that less pressure means you have less oxygen. So if you've ever flown in a commercial aircraft, you've probably felt that your ears pop as you're going up in altitude. They pressurize the airplane, but you're still getting some pressure differential. We teach in the airplane what to do if the canopy fails or there's some type of failure where you don't have that oxygen. So you have to be able to identify in yourself, I'm having hypoxia, right? And so I need to turn on my oxygen system to get more oxygen into my mask. So that's one type of training. Another is, how do we withstand G-forces? So if you've been in a car and you've been turning in a turn, or if you've been on a roller coaster, you'll feel those forces on your body. And that's, you know, a certain number of times the force of gravity. F-16 can go up to 9 times the force of gravity. In a roller coaster, you might get up to maybe 3 times, 2.5 times the force of gravity. So it's a lot of force. Well, what happens when that force is on your body is it will make the blood start rushing out of your head down towards your feet. And you can imagine, if the blood doesn't stay in your brain, what do you think is going to happen? You're going to pass out, right? And so we teach pilots and we teach flight test engineers how to do a thing called a G-strain. And it's where you clench everything in your body and you help push that blood and keep that blood up into your brain. So I had to learn how to do that to make sure I don't pass out in the airplane. And then I also had to do some survival training. All of our fighter aircraft have ejection seats, So if something goes wrong, you can eject, you have a parachute, and so I had to train for what that is. I bring all these up because hypoxia, spatial disorientation, and loss of consciousness due to G-forces are one of the reasons that we lose pilots. So these are all things that AutoGCAS helps with if a pilot passes out. So let's talk about the system. So the automatic ground collision avoidance system, it's a computer, it's an automatic system that will do a maneuver of the airplane away from the ground if controlled flight in the terrain is predicted. We fielded it on 641 of our Air Force aircraft, and we're now putting it on foreign military partner aircraft as well. It's also now on the F-22 and on the F-35, so it's really been a huge success. The F-16 that I worked on was the first one that we did it. Since then, it's saved 12 different pilots. So how the system works, I'm going to show you on here. So first, you know where the airplane is, you know what the trajectory of that airplane is, and then you know where the Earth is. And I say this is kind of like Google Earth on steroids. So if you ever mess around on a map, you can know where the mountains are, where the valleys are. Well, our computers on the airplanes know that. And so it figures out based on what the airplane is doing and where it would go when the last second is to do an activation. And you can probably start thinking to test this could be very risky, right? Because if the system doesn't work right, we might actually hit the mountain. And so that's why we have some ability to do protection buffers. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. So first, let's talk about the low-level mission. So if anyone has seen Top Gun Maverick, usually I ask for hands, but it's a little dark, so I can't quite see you. But in Top Gun Maverick and many other movies, you'll see the airplanes, they fly very low. So they have to fly very low to the ground. And that is a real thing. We do that because it's called terrain masking. And so the ground-to-air radars that are out there cannot see our aircraft. It's been around for decades that we've done that. Well, that means that that our F-16s have to fly sometimes 200 to 500 feet above the ground. So we need to know how to design a system that keeps you from hitting the mountain, but allows you to do that low-level mission. So how do we make that happen? So to safely test the system, we had to make sure that we never relied on the system under test. So we would put in a terrain clearance buffer, which would bounce the ground up to a higher altitude. We also were doing non-operational maneuvers, meaning we're doing maneuvers that pilots have lost their lives in the past. So we have to think about how fast are they going, how steep are they getting to the ground. We would calculate a parameter called time safety margin, and so it's how much time the pilot has to be able to recover the airplane if something goes wrong. You can imagine that if you're very shallow, then you have a lot more time versus very steep. And so those were a lot of things as an engineer I had to calculate the amount of time that was available based on the terrain and the aircraft conditions. So what does it look like? This is a test card. So as an engineer, this is what I'd create. I don't want you to focus on everything that's on there. A couple things that I do want you to see is there's a starting altitude. So we tell the pilot what altitude to start at. There's an airspeed, and then we would tell them a condition to fly down to. And so for this test card, we're telling the pilot that we want them to be at 33,000 feet. We want them to be 630 knots, 85 degrees nose low, which means basically vertical, almost going straight down in a little bit of a bank. And so we're making sure the system activates. All right, the other thing I want to highlight on the right-hand side is in the control room, so as an engineer, on the ground in the control room or in the back seat, I'm monitoring an altitude. And if the auto GCAS does not come on, if the system fails, we're gonna call abort, 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 and the pilot now is gonna manually fly the airplane. It means the computer did something wrong. You can tell that I'm leading you into something, right? We had a system failure. I'm gonna show you what that looks like. And so that number is right here. We're watching that to make sure we stay safe, not trusting the system. I'm going to show you a video to orient you to what you're looking at. I'm going to show you what the maneuver looks like and what you're going to see in the heads-up display. So the video is the heads-up display the pilot is looking at. This test point is going to start level. So the aircraft is up at 43,000 feet level, and they're going to start there. What you'll see in the heads-up display is the flight path marker. So that flight path marker, when it's above the horizon, which is the straight line that goes across, that means that you're climbing a little bit. When it's below the horizon, it means that you're diving, you're going towards the ground. The other thing that you can look at is the current G, so that tells you the number of G forces that the pilot is experiencing. And then on the left is airspeed, so how fast they're going, and finally on the right is altitude. Starting at 44,000 feet, you'll see that that altitude goes down very quickly. The pilot will then roll inverted, so they're gonna roll upside down. They're gonna then pull the nose low, so they're gonna pull G on the airplane to try to get the airplane pointing nose low. And then you're gonna see auto G-cast. So now the computer is thinking about activating those chevrons that you see. When those come together and form a brake X, the computer is now in control. It's going to activate, it's going to roll the airplane and do a pull and roll the airplane away from the ground. All right, so now hopefully you guys are all oriented to what you're gonna watch, and I'm gonna show you the video. On the audio, you're gonna hear the test pilot, and he's talking to the control room. You're gonna hear him saying some numbers, and he's basically calling off the parameters on his test card. So here we go. Rolling inverted. Pulling 4.5 G's to nose low. Auto G cast is on. Engineer monitoring everything, and then you'd also have a control room watching all the parameters. Awesome. So that's a good test point. You guys ready to watch the system failure? This is where the engineering team really comes in. So now this is going to be the exact same test point, exact same conditions, but now we're going to have a system failure. And I call this the blue screen of death. So the computer was not able to manage the amount of information coming in. We'd run this test point before, we'd run it in simulators, no problem. We go out to fly it, and no GCAS, the computer fails. The pilot doesn't realize it because he's flying the airplane, he's at 6 G's, going very fast. It's the control room that realizes the system has failed. They call abort, 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 and the pilot recovers. Same conditions, rolling inverted. Oh, not playing for me. Let me try again. Rolling inverted.
6 G's.
No G pass.
Watch SP, 630 by 30. And idle, pull.
Pilot's in control.
Altitude.
No G pass.
So right there is where the pilot realizes no G pass. So that's why we have a control room, to keep him safe. All right, so now I'm gonna show you a life that was saved by auto GCAST. So this is now, we've done testing, we've fielded the system, and there is a pilot out there, he does a poor G strain, he passes out, and now his airplane is getting lower and lower. You're gonna hear over the radio his wingman in another airplane watching his airplane barrel towards the ground and yelling at him to recover. So this is pretty chilling when you watch it. Real video, real audio, this actually happened. I can make it play. Here we go.
Do you still back up before?
found out about it. He came and talked to us at Edwards, and what he told us is when he woke up to hearing that solid tone, that loud tone of Auto GCAS, he thought that he was in bed and it was his alarm going off. So pretty amazing, pretty rewarding to meet a pilot. All right, so last thing I'm gonna show you with Auto GCAS, I talked about how we prevent the collisions. Well, the other thing is we have to make sure that we don't get in the way. So one of the maneuvers they do is called strafe. And strafe is where you take your airplane, you have a gun that comes out the nose of your airplane, and you have to point the nose towards the ground to shoot that gun. Sometimes they'll get as close as 100 feet off the ground. We had to make sure GCAS would allow them to do that and not activate when it's not supposed to. So you're gonna see a nuisance-free test point where we make sure it doesn't get in the way. So the pilot is turning in that circle that you see on the heads-up display. That's where the bullets go. Now on the right-hand side, you're gonna see the video of him coming in the F-16. That test point, he got down to about 90 feet above the ground. You saw those Auto GCAS chevrons. The system was thinking about activating, but never activated, stayed, it didn't get in the way. And so that's, again, a successful test point, nuisance free. All right, so the last thing I'm gonna talk about with Auto GCAS. So when we first fielded this system, it had only been out there for about 2 weeks, and an operational squadron had to make the decision, do they wanna put this new system on their airplane that they didn't know very much about? Fortunately, they made the decision to put to put Auto GCAS on their airplanes and to take it, and that's when we got our first operational save. So this pilot was downrange. He was protecting Army and Marines that were on the ground, that were calling in for support, and he was driving in with his F-16 to try to use bullets to get folks that were trying to kill our Army and kill our Marines. And while he was doing that, he had target fixation, meaning that he was focusing, trying to make the bullets work, trying to do his job, and didn't realize how close he got to the ground. Auto GCAS activated, and we called it 0.68 seconds from the point of no return. Meaning that if Auto GCAS had delayed by about half a second, he would have hit the ground. So that to us means success. We figured out how to ride that line between being nuisance-free, allowing them to do their normal low-level mission while also activating when they need to. So one more pilot that's alive today because of this system. All right, so now I'm gonna change a little bit. I'm gonna talk about the automatic air collision avoidance system. So how you prevent an airplane from hitting the ground is relatively easy because the ground doesn't move. The ground is always where it's going to be. You have to think about mountains and canyons, but those things don't change. Preventing two airplanes from hitting each other is much more challenging because they're dynamically moving. First, let's talk about why we need this system. So the automatic air collision avoidance system, again, based off historical midairs. This is a video of an animation of a midair mishap that we had at Edwards Air Force Base in 1999. An F-16 turned to avoid some birds, didn't realize that the T-38 was right next to it, and it hit the T-38. Both the pilot and engineer in the T-38 lost their lives. The F-16 was able to come back and land. This shows what Auto ACAS does. It allows the pilot to turn in, but at the last second, it does an automatic maneuver to maneuver the airplane away so it will not hit the other aircraft. And so this is how the system was designed, and so we had to figure out how do we go and test this system. First, let's talk about how the system works. So you have an airplane that is flying along, and it is transmitting where it's at to the other airplane. So both airplanes need to talk to each other, and they need to receive information. Next, the airplane says, okay, based on where you are and where I am, these are the types of maneuvers that I might want to do. Pull up, go to the right, or go down. And so it transmits that information to the other airplane. At the last moment, it'll pick the best maneuver, and it'll do that maneuver. Now, from a design perspective, it works very well. From a flight test perspective, challenging to figure out how do we safely test this. So here's the crux of the problem. How do you test a collision avoidance system without actually causing a collision, without actually causing a midair? So we had difficulties with figuring out how are we effective to make this maneuver actually look like two airplanes are flying next to each other, how are we safe? You can imagine that if two airplanes are never even near each other, okay, you're safe. Then it's not an effective test. Also, we had to come up with new ways to do this test execution and a lot of innovative safety planning. So the first is that we never trusted the system. We call it the mad scientist. We said, we don't know what auto ACAS is gonna do. And so based on every geometry, I'm gonna come up with an exclusion zone. So the idea with this exclusion zone is that if you have two airplanes, you can watch my hands. If you have an airplane that's up and to the left, I say, you can't go down. If an airplane's down and to the right, you can't go up and to the left. And so we exclude those maneuvers. This is easy to think about. You can imagine all our different geometries. As we start thinking about different ways to orient the airplanes, it becomes a lot more challenging. And we had to think about geometry and how to design those exclusion zones. The next is we never relied on the system. So I talked about on auto ground collision avoidance, how we would put a buffer on the ground so the computer thought the ground was higher. Similar for auto ACAS, we would trick the system so the computer thought that the airplanes are co-altitude, but they're actually maybe 200 feet, 300 feet apart from each other. So what this means is if the system doesn't activate, one airplane will just pass the other and we stay safe. So that was the last thing. And finally, to monitor in the control room. So we came up with this parameter, it's time to zero altitude split, and there's some math, pretty simple math, but the concept is that it's not really the altitude itself that matters, it's how quickly you're moving through that altitude, right? So the change in altitude over time is what matters. And so we came up with a parameter that was based on how quick two airplanes are moving, how much altitude you need to have time for the pilots to react. And so our theory was at least 3 seconds. We needed the pilots to have 3 seconds to react and maneuver the airplane away if something wasn't going right. So for every geometry, we had to come up with it. All right, so what does this look like? Again, a test card, tons of stuff. You don't have to focus on all of it, but I'll show you on the test card where you see the parameters. So the altitude split, or the altitude offset, what we tell the computer this aircraft is at is right there on the card. The shooter aircraft, which is the one on the right, sets that. The altitude split, so the difference between the two real pieces of metal, real airplanes, is right on the bottom. So the white airplane is gonna fly at 20,200 feet, and the black airplane is gonna fly at 20,000 feet, giving us a 200 foot difference between them. Those exclusion zones, we put them in. So the airplane that's up to the left can't go down, the one on the bottom of the right can't go up, and so they put those in. So again, lots of data that the test pilot has to type in and monitor while they're flying the airplane. This is where the flight test engineer comes in the back seat, I'm monitoring these parameters, and in the control room, I'm monitoring all this to make sure that we're staying safe. All right, I'm gonna show you a couple videos. The first video is going to be looking back at the backseater as we're doing an automatic maneuver. You're gonna see the airplane down and to the left. He's turning in, so they're turning in near each other. And right here, the computer has taken control and maneuvered the airplane away. You saw that they weren't co-altitude, right? They're a little bit off, and that's that altitude split. This video shows you what the pilot is looking at. So the pilot, yeah, he has all those parameters in his heads-up display, but most of the time, he's glancing up and staring at that airplane as it's getting closer and closer. And once the activation occurs, he's focused on the airplane. So I show those, again, the foot stomp, how engineering comes in to support our pilots that are doing these dynamic maneuvers. All right, now I'm gonna show you a test point. At the end, you're gonna hear the pilot say, that was awesome. And the reason is because this test point, this 5 seconds that you're about to watch took us 2 years to plan. And so this is two airplanes coming in, automatic maneuver happening and maneuvering the airplane away. I'll probably play the video a couple times so that you can orient yourself. On the top left is a heads-up display from the airplane up and to the left. On the top right is a video of the airplane down and to the right. All right, let me play it one more time for you, so that you can see it. There's a lot of stuff happening really quick. Maybe. So 2 years of planning for that one test point. Now luckily we had a lot of test points that we planned for over those 2 years, but that's how seriously we take safety planning and planning for our systems to make sure that one test point where we're getting two airplanes really close to each other
really fast, we could stay safe. All right, so the last thing I'm gonna show you with auto ACAS is the theory of don't get in the way. Remember how I talked about the philosophy is do no harm, do not get in the way, and then prevent collisions? Well, for air collision avoidance system, it's the same. We need to allow the pilots to do normal formation flying to be able to get in close. And so let me show you what that looks like. No auto ACAS activations, pilots just flying normal maneuvers. So you'll see on the bottom right, an airplane coming in, rejoining. They get within about 30 feet of each other. Okay, and so you can kind of see that normal flying, don't get in the way. So with that, a couple final thoughts, and then I'll open it up for questions. So as I mentioned, I've been out at Edwards since 2005. I'll tell you right now, growing up in the Antelope Valley, I never planned to work in aerospace. I never planned to fly in the backseat of airplanes. It's something that I've kind of been at the right place at the right time and had these opportunities. But having the engineering degree, having the ability to communicate and do technical writing, because if I make a plan and I make test cards, I need to be able to communicate that. So it's not just math and science, it's also some graphic arts design, it's technical writing, technical communication. All of those skills were very important for me to have. And the other advice that I give folks is kind of grow where you're planted. I've had these opportunities because I've found something, I've tried to be really good at what I can do, and that's opened doors for me. So I'm super excited to hear if you guys have any questions for me and encourage you to keep looking into engineering, mathematics, and STEM fields. So with that, I'll open it up to questions.
So to the audience, we want to let you know that there are some microphones that our house will be helping you access. And Jessica, while they're coming to the microphones, would you give a briefing about the flyover that's going to happen next week?
I will. Thank you. And I'll tell you, my general rule is I don't let people leave until I get at least 5 questions. So you got to think about some questions for me. They don't have to be hard questions. Don't make them too hard. But I need at least 5 questions. All right, so as people are figuring out what you want to ask, please give me questions. I'm going to talk about the flyover. So next week, if all things go well, if our airplanes are healthy and the weather is good, we should be flying over the Antelope Valley between 11 o'clock until 12 o'clock. So that's on Wednesday, October 12th. We're gonna have a bunch of aircraft from NASA and from the Air Force. So we hope to have a cargo or a tanker aircraft, so a big airplane. And then we hope to have trainer and fighter aircraft. So hopefully a T-38, F-16, F-22, and F-35. And then hopefully we're gonna have a NASA F-18 and F-15. So you guys can research what those are. We're gonna have a path that's gonna try to hit as many schools as possible, and we'll be flying right over you. All things go well, I'll hopefully be in the T-38, and I'll be waving at you as we fly over. So I hope to see you guys out there between 11 o'clock, 11 and 12 o'clock. All right, what questions do you have for me? We'll bring the mic so that people that are live streaming can hear your question. Yep, that works.
There it is. My question is for the mid-air, like avoiding the collisions automatically, do both planes need the system or can it work standalone with one?
That is a great question. So we had to think about that. So we have 2 different versions of the system. So cooperative means that both airplanes are transmitting, both airplanes can do an automatic maneuver. So that's called cooperative. They both have the system, they both have a data link with each other. We also tested non-cooperative. So this is where your main airplane has sensor information that could be from like a video feed or a radar feed. And so it knows where another airplane is. It knows pretty well how fast that airplane is going. And so it'll do a maneuver. Now, I'm not gonna make you guys answer me, but I want you to think in your mind for a second, which type do you think can get closer to each other? Which type do you think can be more nuisance-free? Something that is cooperative and they're both able to work together, or something that is non-cooperative and you have a lot of uncertainty with the other airplane? The non-cooperative, right, is gonna be more nuisance prone for non-cooperative. And so the goal is that we have these all cooperative talking to each other, but we did design for being able to have a non-cooperative solution. Great question. All right, who's gonna follow up? I need at least 4 more.
some of the videos said like unclassified or approved for public release. Are there like a lot of videos you can't show because they're classified?
Yeah, so I can't tell you what's classified. Oh, we got some spies in here. No, so actually everything that comes off of our airplanes, everything is pretty much classified until we unclassify it. So that's kind of our security posture, is just because there are things that we don't want to have shown. Things for public release, so we are very intentional in what videos that we put out for public release, because, you know, it can go wild and go out there. So everything that you've seen today was intentionally, just we're like, these are good things for you to see. And so we went through the process to publicly release them. But unfortunately, yeah, I can't, you know, you can't just show everything. And a lot of times it's not because there's anything classified, it's just because of the effort to go through and review and declassify and publicly release. Thanks. Okay, I have another question over here. Oh, I'm one over here. Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
What's your favorite thing to see while flying?
Oh, my favorite thing. I wish I had the video on here for you. So there's a thing called sun dog. A sun dog is when you're flying and the sun, you know, the reflection of the sun comes through your airplane and it'll create a rainbow. So it'll create a rainbow around your airplane and you will see your shadow. You have to have clouds out, but you'll see your shadow on a cloud and you'll see a rainbow ring around it. And so that's my favorite, is when you're flying with clouds and you can see a sun dog. Very rare. I think I've only ever seen it two times. We very rarely have clouds out here. But that's my favorite thing to see. My second favorite thing is I love flying over the Sierra Nevada mountains here in California. So if you're ever driving up the 395 to go to Mammoth, we regularly fly that way and we fly over the mountains. And so I love looking at the mountains and the snow and the trees. And so that's my favorite. And I'd say my third favorite is probably when we're doing test, which is probably the most important, but testing the system and seeing success. But yeah, sun dogs, the mountains, and then the results of doing testing. All right, another question.
Was anything like in your career spontaneous? Like, did you just make any spontaneous move in like regarding your education or like your career? Or was everything like set and planned?
That's a great question as well. I feel like my entire life has been spontaneous. I don't want to spend too much time on it, but when I went off to college, my plan was not to go into aerospace. My plan wasn't even mechanical engineering. So I thought that I was going to get an engineering degree and then go to law school. I wanted to be a patent lawyer because they make a lot of money. That was the only motivation that I had. Once I got into school, I worked for a law office part-time and I realized I did not like doing law. It was a lot of paperwork, a lot of process. So then I had to start figuring out, what am I going to do? Well, then towards the end of college, I had the opportunity to do an internship out at Edwards Air Force Base. I did that so I could live at home, I could save some money. Again, no plan on actually working out there, no plan on doing aerospace. I got out to Edwards, I love the people, I love the job, kind of the mission focus of it. And then I was like, oh, this is something I could do. And so that was in 2005. I didn't start flying in airplanes until 2014, I think. So quite a while, 2014 or 2015. The first time I flew, I was so sick, I was dizzy, I was throwing up, it was terrible. I was like, I don't know if I need to do this again. So I waited about 6 months and I was like, I'm gonna try again. And knock on wood, since then I've been fine. I got the proper training and I've gotten used to it. Once I started flying, I'm like, man, maybe I wanna go through test pilot school and get this experience. So again, spontaneous, I mean, all of them I had to apply for and I had to be able to get it, but it never has it been like a plan, this is what I'm going to do. It's been because of these opportunities have arisen to me. And I also, that's why I put stop, grow where you're planted, be the best that you can at whatever you're doing. Because I had done well and I had accelerated and I had the engineering degree, that's why I had these opportunities. Great question. Yeah.
Can you tell us about the test pilot school experience? What's the most challenging thing you've ever done?
You know, a lot of people say it's the best year they never want to repeat. I totally repeated again, it was amazing. But it's 1 year, you get an engineering and flight test engineering. So you have, the way that works is in the morning, you have academic classes. So you have 3 to 4 hours of academic classes, master's degree classes on aerodynamics, propulsion systems, electronics, all of that. And then in the afternoon, you're flying. So you fly probably about 80 different times throughout the year. And those flights aren't just going out and having fun. You're collecting data and writing reports. So very, very busy year, but it was an amazing experience. I got to fly in a ton of airplanes. I was in a classroom with some of the smartest military pilots and engineers and system operators. So that was really amazing. Still some of my best friends. So it was a great experience. But yeah, you know, it's a hard year. It's a really, really hard year. I worked most weekends, and you know, my husband was very supportive and able to kind of help out with some of the stuff outside of school, because I just did not have very much free time. Thanks.
With the system, while the airplane is going down and the system is trying to get it back up again, can it also detect that another plane is close and avoid it at the same time?
Oh, you guys have such great questions. Yes. So there was a system, I didn't even present it, but after we tested the ground collision avoidance system and the air collision avoidance system, we realized we needed to think about integrating the two, right? So there's an integrated collision avoidance system that thinks about the ground and another airplane. And so we designed the test and did testing for that. That's even more exciting because you're flying two airplanes kind of near the ground, and even more challenging for how do you do that safely. So yeah, great question. Because if we're gonna field the system, so right now the air collision avoidance system is not fielded on our airplanes yet. We're still developing it and still testing it because it's very challenging. We gotta get it right. Great question. What else? We're gonna get out of here with way more than five questions. It's great.
Where would be the best location to see it?
So the route is still in flux. So I can't tell you the exact route. I can't tell you the exact times, but I will say that it's going to be between 11 o'clock to 12. There is some information that's going out. There's going to be a media release, an official media release pretty soon. The plan right now is it will start from Edwards, and we're going to go up through Boron, Hellendale, Victorville, Hesperia, hit East Palmdale, come kind of along, you know, East Palmdale to Courtsill, to Lancaster, and then head north to Roseman and Tehachapi. So our hope is that most of the valley we're going to be able to hit. But like I said, the actual route and the exact times are still in flux. And it's always going to be, depending on weather, depending on airplanes, there's always some flexibility on what actually happens. So hopefully everyone will get to see it, but we'll see.
What's one big aspiration you have for the future, and how has that guided? I know your life is pretty spontaneous, but how has that guided and molded your past decisions?
Oh, that's a great question. You're going to make me be a little bit reflective. So, you know, most recently I've been an instructor at test pilot school. So I was instructing at test pilot school for 3 years, and I talk about the ground collision avoidance system was very rewarding to work on that. Being an instructor has been very rewarding. I've had multiple students that have come up to me and said they've gotten into flight test because of AutoGCAS. They've had pilots whose lives have been saved because of AutoGCAS. So kind of my inspiration now has been to encourage the next generation. So encourage the new test pilots, the new flight test engineers, so they can develop, you know, they can develop these systems and they can work on these systems. And then also similar, that's why I'm here with you guys today, right? Is trying to get everyone motivated. So that's kind of my aspiration, where I'm going to go. So I'm looking at PhD programs. I'm thinking that doing a doctorate and kind of focusing on technical aspects is something I'm going to want to do. That'll be very challenging. So talk to me in 5 years and I'll let you know. So, but yeah, just kind of keeping us moving, developing technology that has big mission impact. Yeah. Two more questions. I have time for two more.
So I know that in like any career, there's always that one thing that you favor or something that happened that was like your favorite thing and like you just want to do it again. So what plane did you get to fly that was your favorite, and like what about it made it your favorite experience?
Okay, so the cheesy answer that I give is the next airplane I'm going to fly is my favorite, because I'm always looking forward to the future airplane. But looking back on the past, man, I've gotten to do some awesome stuff. Probably the one that stands out the most to me is there's an aircraft called the C-130. It's a cargo airplane. And that is an airplane that has not just the pilots, but it has combat system operators that are monitoring the video feed on it. It has a navigator that's figuring out how do they fly low in the weather and close to the ground. And then it has gunners. So it has folks that literally have a gun that they can shoot out the side of the airplane to help protect the airplane and help protect people on the ground. So I got to fly in that a couple years ago, and it was so different than anything I had flown before, because I've been flying fighter aircraft. So flying in the C-130 with a crew of 10 different people with all these different backgrounds, that's the one that stands out the most to me, is something in my mind. I felt like, it was a really amazing opportunity. Yep. All right, here's my last question. I'll stick around afterwards if you have questions for me too. Okay, go ahead.
With the auto GCAS, how does it deal with unconscious people? Like, does it land the plane itself, or like, how does it deal with that?
Yeah, so that's a great question. How does auto GCAS deal with an unconscious person? So fortunately, when a pilot passes out from G loss of consciousness, GLOC, they usually come to pretty quickly. So if the auto GCAS is recovered and all the saves that we've seen today, usually the pilot wakes up. A lot of times they wake up before the maneuver is even done. They wake up before. If the pilot didn't wake up right away, auto GCAS would keep activating until they wake up. The one caveat is in the F-16, the throttle position that gives you power is not, we can't make it automatic. So if the throttle isn't up, if they have the throttle back, that means that eventually the airplane will run out of power, it's gonna run out of thrust, and it'll fall to the ground. Our new airplanes, both the F-22 and the F-35, they have an auto throttle capability. So for them, if auto GCAS activates, it'll fly up, the throttle comes up, and it'll just fly in an orbit, and it'll wait until the pilot comes to. So our new airplanes are a little bit better. For our old F-16, I call it, we kind of had to put a Band-Aid and just make it work. If the pilot doesn't wake up, eventually the airplane would crash. But hopefully that never happens. So, great question.
Can we do two more?
Of course, yeah. You guys have great questions. Making me think a little bit, I like it.
Systems be developed for commercial planes, or have they already been used for commercial planes?
That's another great question. So yes, they're not on our commercial airplanes yet. We've been working with NASA. So NASA works a lot with FAA and with the airspace. And so they're developing these. The ground collision avoidance system is the one that they're really looking at in commercial airplanes. Now, you're not going to pass out and, you know, you're not going to lose consciousness, but they do get in the weather. They can get disorientation. And so they're working on that in the same design philosophy. The midair, so the air-to-air, commercial aircraft don't really fly like military aircraft. So we're not as focused on the mid-air prevention portion of it, but the ground collision avoidance system, yes. And I'm told that very soon, I don't know exactly when, but very soon these systems will be on our commercial airplanes. So thank you. One more question. Have one in the back. Over there? Okay. Like I said, I'll stick around if people want to come talk to me afterwards.
Would these systems work on like helicopters or just planes?
Yeah, so helicopters definitely, helicopters move a lot slower, but they also get very close to the ground, right? You're talking, I mean, if they're in hover, they're like 10 feet above the ground. So they do have systems. What I have seen on helicopters have been more a sensor that looks out in front, because if you're getting 10 feet, 20 feet above the ground, a tree matters. Right, so your Google Earth isn't going to have that tree. So the helicopters have more of a sensor that looks out, it figures out what the terrain looks like, what the trees look like out in front, and then it feeds that information to the pilot. So helicopters haven't been using automatic as much. They've been doing more pilot cueing and more advisory stuff. Because again, you're not really going to have to worry about a pilot passing out because they don't pull G's. And it's moving slower, so you don't have to have, you have a little bit more time, pilot can react. But yeah, collision avoidance is applicable to all airplanes. It's applicable to your car as well. So one thing I tell people to think about, if you're driving your car or riding along with your parents, a lot of cars now have advisory collision avoidance that will come on and do beeping, and it's a lot of the same type of philosophy. So, awesome. All right, well, I think that is it. Thank you so much. We want to thank Jessica for being here today, and I'm sure all of you agree this was a fabulous presentation. And my tip for seeing all of the planes next Wednesday is look out.
Always.
Yes.
Jessica will be in the lobby to answer any questions, so you can meet her out there. Thank you all for being here today, and Jessica, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. It was wonderful.
Thank you.